host Piers Morgan has also paid tribute to Queen Elizabeth II, saying that he struggles to imagine Britain without our Queen. Piers joins us now. Piers, good evening to you. Nice for you to be with us this evening. Wish it was under better circumstances. How are you feeling?
Do you know, it's actually one of the saddest days of my life, and I'm surprised. I feel quite as intensely about it as I do, but I think it's one of those things when we didn't really realise as a country quite what we were losing until she'd gone. And we were obviously aware she's had ill health, obviously aware of her great age. But I think the fact that we this afternoon just suddenly heard the Queen has died, I felt like it was a real shock to my system. And I felt very sad about it all night. I've been doing anchoring rolling coverage here on the show, Piers Morgan Uncensored. And every guest we've had who's from Britain has felt the same way. It's like we just feel this collective sense of loss and sadness. You know, I think Liam Gallagher, the pop star, just tweeted gutted. And that's how I felt. Mm. It's just a really gutting moment.
Sure is.
It is that overwhelming sense of sadness. And I think because it came on so quickly, we only saw her 2 days ago and she was looking frail but seemed to be okay. But I think that when you say that you can't imagine Britain without this Queen, I think that sums up the sentiment of all of us.
Yeah, well, it's a strange thing, isn't it? She's been the Queen for 70 years. You know, I'm 57, so she was on the throne 13 years before I was even born. And I'm not a spring chicken. So I just feel like the magnitude of her reign, longest reigning British monarch, longest reigning monarch in the history of the world, outside of a French king who was four when he took over. This doesn't really count. So she was the GOAT, the greatest of all time. And uniquely, I don't want to be saying Piers Morgan calls the Queen a GOAT, but in sporting parlance, she was the greatest. And I think the great thing about her was that she had this common touch to go with the regality. So I watched her around the public many times, and she was just incredible with ordinary members of the public, always aware that they were just, you know, couldn't believe they were meeting the Queen, always put them at ease, always happy to chat with them, always calm, never panicked, didn't matter what was going on in the world. And she was like this gigantic comfort blanket. She would celebrate with us when we wanted to celebrate. She would console us through the difficult times. She was stoic. She was resilient. She was strong. She had this overwhelming sense of duty and service to her country. And even this week, as she was dying, what was she doing? She was greeting the new British Prime Minister and saying goodbye to the previous one up at Balmoral. And you could see from just her hands that she was clearly extremely unwell, but she did it because she felt it was her duty, her constitutional duty. And what a thing to do in your dying days, to do that because your country comes before your own health. So I met her a few times. She was a remarkable woman, very funny, very intelligent, highly well-read, and she met everybody. You know, she met 13 American presidents, 15 British prime ministers, 100 world leaders. And she had this wisdom that came from experience, longevity, and all these people. And that picture you're just showing now, it was quite funny. It was a She was having a party for media people at Windsor Castle. And we looked out onto the gardens. And I said to Your Majesty, do you actually like the garden parties you have to host? He has these huge garden parties. And she looked at me and laughed. And she went, well, Mr. Morgan, let me put it to you like this. How would you like having 12,000 complete strangers trampling over your lawns? And then she burst out laughing. And that's the moment she and I burst out laughing at her joke. And it was very disarming to hear her like that, because, of course, you only know her from her public appearances. But she never gave interviews. She never gave political opinions. That's why it doesn't really matter what your politics are. That's why everyone in Britain, I think, has come together and is collectively moved by her, because she wasn't divisive. She wasn't polarizing. She didn't say things which annoyed people. She was the complete opposite of someone like me, who's deliberately provocative. She was the opposite. She was a calming, steady influence of non-partisanship, who just wanted unity and people to come together. And I thank God that we had her as a monarch. And I hope that Charles can live up to even even be half as good, because then we'll be very lucky.
Pierce, you've managed to, in the last 5 minutes, impersonate the Queen, call her a goat and a comfort blanket. You're not dull, my friend. You are not dull.
A gigantic comfort.
That's it. Can I ask you this, and just on Charles, because we've been talking about this all morning. You know, the issues with Harry, and Harry, obviously, unfortunately for him, I'm sure, missing the passing of his queen and his grandma. How is Charles going to navigate his way through this next couple of days, and what sort of a king will he be?
Well, it's very difficult, isn't it? Because Charles, I know from people I've spoken to this week, has been left completely baffled and hurt and heartbroken by the way his son's been treating him. No doubt egged on by his wife, Meghan, who seems to want to take down the royal family, take down the monarchy. And it's been incredibly hurtful to the royals and Charles in particular. This is his son. You've also got the running feud between William and Harry, which would have broken Diana's heart. I know that. I knew her well, and she would have been heartbroken by what's going on. But when you have, you know, someone like Meghan Markle, we've talked about this before. I don't want really even to mention her tonight, to be honest. But when you have somebody who's decided to break away from the royal family, keep the royal titles, flog them for tens of millions of dollars to the highest bidders, and then use those platforms to mercilessly attack the royals and the monarchy, it's incredibly distressing for those who are left back in the country trying to do their duty and do their jobs. Charles has got to try and reconcile, I think, his two sons, and he's got to try if he can, to explain to Meghan Markle and to other royals who may want to behave in this manner. Look at the Queen. Look at how beloved the Queen was. Mm. She was beloved because she was a unifying figure.
Yes.
She wasn't someone who exploited her status or her royal titles. Mm. She was somebody who wasn't in it for personal gain. She was in it for the good of the country. Look at what she did, and try and learn some of the values of the Queen. Resilience and strength, and humility, and service, and duty. Be more like that, and the public may like you more. So I hope he can reconcile his sons. I hope that Meghan Markle will back off the royals now and give them some time and space for Charles to be a king and to grow as a king, because otherwise the future of the monarchy is in jeopardy, and that would be, for me, as someone who believes strongly in the monarchy, it would be a tragedy.
Well, this is potentially an opportunity for that feud to end and to bring him back into the fold at a time of great sadness for the whole family.
Yeah, look, these things can go one of two ways, can't they?
Yeah.
This could either be a catalyst for a far worse rift, because emotions will be running so raw. I can't even imagine what's going on up at Balmoral, where William and Harry, who've been at Windsor in the park there in separate houses without even saying hello to each other this week. And now they're in the same building mourning their grandmother, but they haven't spoken in months. And the hatred that they feel to each other is palpable. What is going on there? We don't know. We probably never know. But it's got to be incredibly tense. And so it can either be something which heals a rift and they come together and they put this as the reason to now move on and do it in respect to memory of their grandmother, or it will make things 10 times worse. I hope it's the healing, because we need it. Charles needs it. He's going to be king. He can't have his two sons at war. He can't have his youngest son hating him. It's a terrible situation.
The Queen was always able to, during the most difficult of times, bring the nation together. We know Great Britain's going through a pretty awful time at the moment with cost of living pressures, and it is divisive over there. Whether he can bring his own family together and the nation together, there's one thing for certain: they are coming together for the Queen. What will be your lasting and enduring memories, Pierce?
I just think that she was a unique person. You know, not only was she the longest reigning monarch, but she was the best, because she understood instinctively what the point of a monarchy is. They're unelected officials, but she was able to reign for 70 years and never put a foot wrong, because she always understood it wasn't about her, that she was the figurehead and representative of the country and the Commonwealth, and that the values that she espoused were the values that the world would view Britain and the Commonwealth as having. And those values are values which I think, sadly, have been going out of fashion in society. You know, her stiff upper lip, her lack of public emotion, you know, her resilience, her mental strength, her stoicism, this sense of duty that she had. Those are things which we should be proud of, which society ought to get back more to celebrating. She never played the victim, which is the modern curse. She never wanted things to all be about her, another modern phenomenon. She wanted it to be about others, to help those who had less than she did, to help the country. And I think that is her lasting legacy. She was the greatest of all time. Because she was someone who understood better than any monarch that came before her what the point of the monarchy and what the point of her job was. And she did it better than anybody else.
Beautifully said.
Beautifully said, Piers. Just very quickly, any funny memories to finish on? She did have a wicked sense of humour.
I do remember a time when I was a judge on Britain's Got Talent, and the prize used to be that you got to perform at the Royal Variety Show, this annual show in front of the Royals. And so we were up in Liverpool, and I was with Simon Cowell. In fact, you showed a picture of me with the Queen earlier, Simon Cowell's in the background there, and that was where it happened. Well, what that picture doesn't show is that Prince Philip had just come down, and it was a guy, could you remember Paul Potts, the opera singer, who won the first series Britain's Got Talent, sang Ness and Dorma. He was a car phone warehouse salesman.
That's right.
Anyway, he was to my right on this picture. And Philip had come down and went, oh, he said, yes, now. And he turned back to Simon Cowell, having already said, who are you? Which made me laugh out loud. And he said, let me get this straight. He said, so you, pointing at Cowell, sponge off him, pointing at Paul Potts. And then we all thought of that laughing. And Cowell didn't know what to say, completely lost the words. And off he went, and we all just burst out laughing because we all had our rude Philip moment, which is all anybody ever wanted. And then the Queen had to come back after it, picking up the pieces. Hello, lovely to see you all.
Smooth it all over.
And he'd been calling us all a bunch of sponges. It was great. They were a great team, and I think the only nice thing about today, of a very sad day, is that she's now reunited with Philip. They were one of the all-time great teams, and I think she never really recovered from losing him, and they're back together tonight, I believe that, and I think that's a great solace. I think when we look at the Queen and her life, she's now back with the man who was there every step of the way and who she's been mourning for the last year and a half or so, and I'm happy about that.
You're like a teddy bear. You really loved her.
I did, actually, more than I realised. And that's why I say it's been a very sad day and not without the odd tear. And I think I'm not the only person in Britain who probably felt they had a steely heart about these things. And actually, when it came to the moment of realisation that we'd lost the Queen, we realised what it meant and what she means and what she means for Britain and the Commonwealth and what she means for, I guess, what it means to be British. You know, we all struggle with, what does it mean to be British? Well, she was what it meant to be British. Everything she stood for, everything, is what is good about this country. And that's why tonight you're seeing these extraordinary scenes at the palace. People go and pay their respect. They just want to be there. My wife and 10-year-old daughter were watching the coverage and were so moved, they've gone up to the palace just to stand there and be part of it. And it's very quiet and very dignified and respectful, very like the Queen. And they're just then in complete contrast, of course, to the Jubilee scenes where there were huge ovations and cheering and parties and street dances. Tonight is just a chance to say thank you. And I think that's what we all feel, a very sad day, but a day to feel extraordinarily grateful to this remarkable woman.
Wow.
And what she gave her country and the Commonwealth.
Beautifully said, Piers. Thank you so much for being with us, my friend. Piers Morgan, Uncensored. Thank you.